In this lesson, we're gonna see how we can plot our data, how we can create charts. We've seen a couple of plots here and there in the previous lessons, but now we're gonna dig deeper and I wanna explain you the details on how everything is working. The library that we are using to plot data is actually Matplotlib. It's probably the most powerful and most popular library in Python to plot data. It's also one of the libraries that's been around for the longest time. It's been around for pretty much forever. So you are going to find a lot of documentation and references online about it. The problem with Matplotlib is that it's extremely powerful, but it's also very difficult to use. It doesn't have a consistent well-crafted API. It was actually inspired by MATLAB. So there, it has a global API, which is not very intuitive for Python developers. So we will try to stay away from Matplotlib. There are actually bridges built or other libraries working on top of Matplotlib that are simplifying the way to create plots with it. So usually we will try to stay away from it. Matplotlib is like this very, very, very powerful library, which can do pretty much whatever. There is a huge gallery here in the documentation with examples from pretty much everything. We have a couple with 3D plots. They are drawing logos, they are drawing MRIs, all with Matplotlib. So you can see how powerful it is. But again, it's complicated to use. So we will try to stay away from it and try to use high level libraries as much as we can. One of these high level libraries is actually Pandas. Pandas has a built-in interface that will let you plot your data frames, your series using Matplotlib. So we are using Matplotlib, but the API or the way to use it is actually through Pandas, which is a very a much nicer API than just the standard Matplotlib. I will include at the end of this lesson, I will include a quick reference of how Matplotlib is working. But again, usually you will try to stay away from it and not use it directly. In following lessons, we're gonna explore, for example, Seaborn, which also uses Matplotlib, and it's gonna be a lot more user-friendly. Something else to note about Matplotlib is that it's a static library, and it's usually for 2D plots. There are examples with 3D plots, as the one I showed you before, these two, but usually we will be creating 2D plots, which again are static. They are not animated, although there is an animation plugin, and they are not dynamic like JavaScript dynamic. Like you can, for example, zoom in or change things or make the charts dynamic. For that, we're gonna use Bokeh later. So let's get started. And again, we're gonna be using Pandas API to use Matplotlib, which is the plot method, which is present in both data frames and series. You can use it in pretty much both of them. And again, underneath, it is using Matplotlib. It's actually right here, but it has a much nicer API. The data is already pulled. It's in the form, in this case, of a data frame. You can just plot what you have just pulled. So it's a lot easier. And it's fairly powerful. We have a variety of different plots to create: a line plot, a bar chart, histograms, pie plots, scatter plots, etc. We actually have two methods, or two APIs to access these plots. And I'm gonna show you in detail what I mean. So we've pulled our data, NBA statistics from players, just some sample data set to get started. And I want to show you the first example, which is plotting a scatter plot comparing two variables, FGA compared to FG. FGA is field goals attempts, right? So if you're not very familiar with basketball, it's basically players shooting, right? They are trying, they are making an attempt at shooting compared to how many goals they have scored, right? So this is how much they are trying to score, and this is how much they score, right? How many attempts they made on the x-axis, how many attempts they actually made, or how many goals they scored on the y-axis. This is what we call a scatter plot, and it again lets you create this relationship or draw this relationship between two variables. If you have a diagonal, some sort of a straight line, that means that there is some certain correlation between the two variables. If the scatter plot just looks like dots all around, there is no correlation at all. Usually, that's the way we're gonna see a scatter plot. The interface we're using is, again, the one from Pandas. We have our data frame, and we do data frame dot plot. The kind of plot we want is a scatter plot, and this again is what we get from the documentation. We say kind equals a scatter plot right here, and then we say on the x-axis we wanna plot the FGA column. This is a column from the data frame FGA, and on the y-axis we wanna plot FG field goals. Color orange, and in this case, fig size is the figure size. There are a couple more parameters you can inspect in the Pandas API. The chart or the plot that you see right here, this figure, is actually created by Matplotlib, right? So we can see right here in the output, it says Matplotlib axis, etc. So again, this is a Matplotlib chart, but it was created with a Pandas interface, and you can see how simple it gets. There is a small change addition to the API in Pandas. Instead of saying kind equals scatter or kind equals pi, kind equals line, you can just do a dot and here put the type of the plot that you want, either scatter, pi, etc. So that's what I'm doing right here. df.plot, instead of saying kind scatter, I can just do dot scatter, and that's going to be pretty much the same as kind equals scatter. And the chart, as you can see, is exactly the same. So you can again see if there is any correlation between anything. So in this case, the field goal score with the age, in this case, just doesn't seem to be any relationship whatsoever. There's a very good example of a not so useful scatter plot. So as a summary, if you don't know what a scatter plot is, again, it will let you compare two variables, right, in the same figure. So moving forward, what about bar plots? In this case, bar plots are very simple to use. What we're gonna use is kind equals bar, and we're plotting just the age, in this case, of the first 10 players. Okay, so as usual, you can't have too many bars in your plots. Usually you're gonna have between whatever, 10, 20, 30 bars, and that's gonna be it. And let me show you a couple more examples here. The player and the age. And what you can see right here in this subsection, what I'm doing is I am selecting one particular column from the data frame. That means that this thing right here, this is gonna be a series. So again, the series has also the same API. You can do plot.bar, or you can use plot equals kind, sorry, kind equals bar. Again, the interface is gonna be the same. Remember when we did the value counts, this was sort of an aggregation, right? It was kind of a group by counting operation. This is a series. You can very much plot this series. Once you get value counts, you can just plot equals kind equals bar, or plot.bar, whatever it works better for you. And again, you have pretty much a count of how many players for per position you have. Again, this is sort of a grouping operation that is very handy, and it's extremely simple to create. Line plots, and just another type of plot, we're gonna see in more detail how they work. Pie plots, there is not a lot to add here. You can follow the examples later. The value counts we did before will also let you create sort of a percentage relationship in the whole data set with kind equals pie. A histogram and a KDE. A histogram just show you the distribution of a given variable. We will be using Seaborn usually to create histograms and some other statistical charts actually in the next section. So keep an eye for Seaborn, especially for histograms and KDEs and box plots and all those. A KDE is a kernel density estimator. It basically works in the same way as a histogram, but it simulates that the variable, or tries to estimate the variable as a continuous variable. So just another example of what you can create. A box plot is an incredibly useful type of plot. This is one that we will also use with Seaborn, especially all these statistical ones will be used with Seaborn. And again, it will give you an idea of where your data is concentrated, and it will also give you an idea of the outliers, if any. This is something we're gonna see in detail later. We will actually analyze how box plots are created, what are outliers, how are outliers calculated, the formulas and all that. So a couple more examples using box plots here and there. The interface is the same, plot coin box or plot.box, it's pretty much the same. This one accepts actually another parameter in which you say subplots. It's gonna divide each box plot in its own subplot. So now, a real world example, we're pulling Bitcoin data, something we've used before, and this is something we did it, we did before, was just plotting the data. In this case, what I'm gonna do is just DataFrame.plot, and I have a good idea of, or I get the plot of my given data frame. In this case, I'm plotting the whole data frame because that's the only column that I have. If you have multiple columns, of course, you should select what columns you want to plot. Now, this is the time when I'm gonna show you with a little bit more detail how the Matplotlib interface or API works. If you check at the beginning how we imported the data, I did something like from Matplotlib, plotlib.pyplot import, or actually import as PLT. So this is the global access to the Matplotlib API. This Matplotlib API has this plt.plot function that accepts two things, what to plot in the x-axis, or basically what's the value on the x-axis and what's the value in the y-axis. It's a function, right? Something, it's just a regular algebraic function, x, y. So in this case, a Bitcoin price, May the 1st was something, a Bitcoin price, June the 1st with something else. And with these list of points that you are passing, X and Y, Matplotlib is actually filling the blanks and creating a continuous line. So you're just passing again the list of all the X axis points and all the Y axis points. So we will actually do that. I can actually split this into two lines to show you in detail. I'm generating X values here, 10 values from 0 to 9, and I'm generating 10 values in the y-axis, right? The formula right here is f of x equals x squared. I'm just taking each value and squaring it. Now, these two lists, they can be used, right, to create the regular plot. Usually, if you're using NumPy and you wanna follow like a concise API, Matplotlib is gonna help you. Right here, you can just do, you don't need to do all these like creating variables and all that. You can just do these and it's gonna work in the same way. So it's usually, Matplotlib plays usually very well with NumPy. So here's another example, just something else for you to try up. And again, you're always passing the X values, the Y values. In this case, we are generating in one values. This is just for you to have a clear picture of what we're doing. You don't need to do this. Just again, we want to show you explicitly that this is another list. You have the list of X values and the list of Y values. And of course, they have to be of the same length. So you have a value at 0 in X, value at Y in X, value 2.5 in X, value at 2.5 Y, etc. And again, in this case, what I'm doing is plt.plot several times in order to get these data. plt.plots will take multiple values, so I can change, for example, the type of the plot and the type of line. Let me see if this works. There we go. So setting a different color, red, the type of marker and the type of line. So there is actually a couple of lessons that deal with detail about this, but just for you to be aware of it, Matplotlib is very powerful and flexible. And in this case, what I'm doing is first setting the total size of the plot first, then I plot two things, these two curves, which automatically receive different colors, and at the end, I'm just setting the title of the plot. So again, this is a general idea of how the Matplotlib API works. Another example right here, plotting two more lines and also plotting their legends, right? So I'm plotting here the two legends for them. Let's see now, finally, to wrap it up, we have the original df.plot that was generated with Pandas, and now we have here the counterpart, the equivalent, using the standard naked, if you want, Matplotlib API. So the first thing I do is I set the total figure size, I set the title, I plot on the x-axis, I plot the index of my data frame. In the y-axis, I plot the price. So index price, index price, index price. I set the label for my plot. It's gonna be this one right here. And finally, I'm changing the color just because I wanna make a difference here. Look that this plot function also accepts color. Today, I did something like just a parameter r, dash, dot, etc. This is another way of expressing color. Finally, I show the legend. It's gonna make a little bit more sense now. There you go. Bitcoin price is a legend that I'm showing. And again, the plot is right there. The index or the x-axis doesn't look so nice as with Pandas, right? So that's why, again, usually we will recommend you against the usage of Matplotlib directly. If you can use Pandas to create your plots, it's usually a lot more convenient. Pretty much compare how easy it is to plot the Bitcoin price right here. It's just one line. We set the figure size, we set the title, and we're done with it. Pandas is taking care of setting the legends, creating a nice x-axis, etc. With Matplotlib directly, just using it by itself, it's a lot more complicated. We have several lines and the x-axis isn't not even close to be so nice as this one it is. And actually it's gonna be a little bit more complicated to make it look like this chart right here. So now finally, anytime you create a plot, it's very simple to save it to its own file. The plt.saveFigure function will let you save whatever you have plotted. So in this case, you first plot whatever you want, and then you immediately do plt.saveFigure. SaveFig is the function, and you pass the name of the function, of the data file, the image file that you wanna create. In this case, SaveFigure, what it does is it infers the type of image that you want from the name. So this is gonna be a PNG image. If I do the same thing with the other plot that I created, this one right here, and I save it as a JPEG, it's also inferring the type of the image, and those two plots are of the correct type. So let me refresh here. We're gonna open plot one, which is a PNG, and this is the data frame Bitcoin price. Plot 2.jpg, again, the correct image type, is now, this is the one we created directly with the Matplotlib API. So again, just save fig, it's gonna let you create the save store, the plot as an image. You will have to take care of the total size of the image, which in turn is actually in inches. It's not in pixels. It's difficult to think about it. But again, just create a large image, and in any case, you can resize it later. Remember, try to always use at least for now, try to use Pandas to create your plots. Try to use Pandas to do your creation of plots in whatever way you need, creating series, intermediate series, creating data frames, etc. Try to stay away from Matplotlib's API. We're gonna see it in a little bit more detail later, and as soon as we can, we will start using Seaborn, which is an amazing library for statistical types of plots.